One of the complication of the gallstone is that whenever the cystic duct is wide and the stones are small, so these stones can slip into the common bile duct. And when they get into the common bile duct, they either, if they are really very small and the sphincter of Oda is not stenosed, and they may pass into the duodenum unnoticed. Or sometimes while passing through the sphincter, they may induce transient pain and cholangitis or pancreatitis. But the stones are large, they may get lodged into the common bile duct for a long time. And sometimes in common bile duct, they grow inside and they cause complete obstruction or partial obstruction to the common bile duct, causing jaundice. So basically, these stones in the common bile ducts, it can be single or multiple. And in 5 to 7% of the patient who undergo cholecystectomy or patient who are diagnosed with gallstone on ultrasonography, they will have concomitant gallstones. As overall, 5 to 7% of the gallbladder stones, they will have simultaneously CBD stones. Basically, there are two types of CBD stones. One is a primary stone and secondary stone. Primary stone is the stones that are formed inside the common bile duct. And the stones which are migrated from the gallbladder to the common bile duct, they are the secondary stones. So in practice, we get almost 98% stones, they are the secondary stones which are migrated from the common bile duct. Only 2% stones, they are the primary stones. So these primary stones are formed inside the common bile duct, as we discussed for the pathogenesis of any stone. What is the most important factor? The bile has to be, you know, super saturated. There should be infection or some nidus for the stone to form. And third most factor is the stasis. So there has to be stasis of the bile into the common bile duct to get the primary stones. So the stasis is formed again wherever there is an obstruction to the biliary flow into the common bile duct. The commonest cause for the obstruction to the biliary flow is the biliary strictures, like ampullary strictures or the lower CBD variant stricture due to some worm infestations or some autoimmune disease or sclerosing cholangitis. So all this causes stasis of the common bile duct, the bile into the common bile duct and the stone formation. Another important cause for the primary stone is the colorectal cyst. So there is a congenital dilatation of the extrahepatic and intrahepatic biliary radicals. There are different types of colorectal cyst. So because of there is a dilated system, it is non-contractile. So again, because of that, remain there accumulated, and that is again a reason for the stasis and the stone formations. So these are the two important conditions. First is the stricture, worm infestation in the common bile duct, and the colorectal cyst where there is a stasis, which leads to the primary stones. And the secondary stone, obviously, they are migrated from the gallbladder. So whatever is the symptom, stone is there, whether primary or secondary, symptoms are almost same most of the time. They are associated with the pain in the right upper chondrotic region. This pain is because of the two reasons again. First is the, if there is a stone get impacted at the ampulla, again there will be obstruction of the luminal structure like common bile duct, so there will be colicky pain. If there is a prolonged obstruction and there is a infection of the bile into the common bile duct or intrahepatic biliary radicals, so it turns into cholangitis. So it can be biliary colicky pain, or there may be inflammatory continuous pain. So this cholangitis associated with jaundice and pain is known as the Charcot's triad. So obstructive jaundice with fever is known as Charcot's triad. It gives a obstructive jaundice with cholangitis. Okay. So only almost 30% of the patients, they present with the Charcot's trial, where there will be pain, fever, jaundice. Sometimes this patient may just present with the jaundice without fever and pain. Or sometimes they may just present with the pain, which is a biliary pain with jaundice, but no fever. So that is a non-infective obstructive pain. On investigations, as far as this biochemistry is concerned, there are five biochemical markers for the diagnosis of obstructive jaundice. First is serum bilirubin. Second is alkaline phosphatase. Then the third is HGOT, then HGPT, and then GGTP. Serum bilirubin is most sensitive and specific for the obstructive jaundice. But the serum bilirubin with GGTP is more specific than serum bilirubin itself. The serum bilirubin may rise because of the hemolytic jaundice, hemolysis. So it's not necessary due to obstruction. But if you want to prove that bilirubin is raised, so normally in the obstructive jaundice, direct bilirubin is raised, and in non-obstructive jaundice, indirect bilirubin is raised. So if the direct bilirubin is raised with GGTP, it is more specific of obstructive jaundice. Okay. Then in spite of this increased bilirubin and normal these biochemical markers, that means serum bilirubin will be normal, HGOT, HGPT will be normal, and GGTP will also normal. In spite of that, still there are 7% chances that patient may have found bile duct stones. So that's why these biochemical markers, they are specific, but they are not very sensitive. Okay. So after that, the choice of investigation is ultrasonography. Ultrasonography is a very screening procedure to confirm the stones. Its sensitivity is 53 to 70%. So very wide range. It's because it is a operator dependent. And also it is a machine dependent. How sophisticated or high-end machine you are using, and how trained sonologist is there, that makes a lot of difference. Specificity is 90%. And it is a major limitation for the retroduodenal or intrapancreatic portion of corn bile duct stone. That means if the stones are there in the retroduodenal portion of corn bile duct, or the stones are in the intrapancreatic portion of the corn bile ducts, they are not very easy to diagnose on the conventional ultrasonography. Especially the biliary tree is not dilated and the stones are small. If the biliary tree is dilated, then it's easy to pick on the routine ultrasonography. But if it's non-biliary tree, they are not easy. So in that case, the best investigation, the first, and it can be like MCQ, the first choice of investigation to diagnose stones in the retroduodenal or intrapancreatic portion of the corn bile duct when the system is not dilated is the endoscopic ultrasonography. You can appreciate here in endoscopic ultrasonography, you are going into the duodenum and sitting on the corn bile duct, you are tracing whole of the corn bile duct. So this is a corn bile duct. This is a small stone at the ampulla. This is ampulla. This is pancreatic duct. So both are opening at the ampulla. Also, you can diagnose this gallbladder sand. Okay. So this like crystals into the gallbladder or the corn bile duct. They are also diagnosed only on endoscopic ultrasonography. So endoscopic ultrasonography is the preferred investigations for the suspected corn bile duct stones, which are not seen on the routine ultrasonography. Another investigation which can be done is the MRCP. So MRCP has good sensitivity if the stone is more than 10 mm in size, but sensitivity and specificity drops to 30% if the stone is less than 6 mm. And if the biliary tree is not dilated. So the MRCP is a good investigation for a dilated biliary tree and when there are stones are large in size. Also in aerobilia, you get false positive. Again, there are limitations for the patient with pacemaker, patients who are claustrophobic. Again, this test cannot be done. And it cannot also differentiate between the sludge and the mucus plug. MRCP is a good investigation if you really want to study the biliary anatomy. If you are on ultrasonography, you are suspecting some anomalous biliary anatomy. Like there are two wide common hepatic ducts, or there is an aberrant insertion of the cystic duct. So whatever biliary anatomy which is aberrant and you are suspecting on the So, so MRCP is good for the if you really want to study the biliary anatomy. Next investigation is the CT scan. Again, on the CT scan also we can do CT cholangiograph. You can appreciate here dilated corn bile duct, uniformly dilated with narrowing at the ampulla. So it is also a very good investigation. Sensitivity, specificity is more than 90%. But CT cholangiograph gives lots of radiation. So that's the only limitations. So amount of radiation patient receives is not justified if your other equally good investigation modalities like endoscopic ultrasonography or the MRCP. Again, so again, it has got a very good sensitivity, specificity, but ERCPT is an invasive procedure and it is associated with other serious complications like pancreatitis and perforation, bleeding. So that's why ERCP is not recommended as a diagnostic tool to diagnose corn bile duct stones. Okay. So in another choice of investigations, if you are suspecting stone intraoperatively, so preoperatively you thought there is no corn bile duct stones, there are only gallstones and you are taking this patient for cholecystectomy. But intraoperatively, if you think the corn bile duct is dilated or there is a some filling defect is felt intraoperatively, then we can do intraoperative cholangiogram. So you can inject dye inside the corn bile duct and under the fluoroscopy, you can see this cholangiogram and you can diagnose corn bile duct stones if at all is there. So, in clinical practice, how will we diagnose corn bile duct stones? First, you do biochemical markers. That means if there is an increase in serum bilirubin with increase in alkaline phosphatase or GGTP. If they are increased, you must suspect there is obstruction to the there is obstructive jaundice. Then, to know the cause of obstruction, we can do ultrasonography. And ultrasonography, you will be able to see there is a stone in the corn bile duct. There is a dilatation of the corn bile duct and the IHBR. Or if at all there is any associated pathology like stricture or ampullary mass, that also can be seen. If you are able to see the stone ultrasonography, you need not to do any of these investigations. Just stop there. Ultrasonography is good enough to manage these patients. But if you are not able to see the stone, but patient is having jaundice, or there is a just dilated CBD, but stone is not again seen. And just to confirm that CBD is dilated because of the stone and not because of the ampullary pathology like ampullary stricture or mass, we can go ahead with the next line of investigations. So in next line, the preferred investigation is endoscopic ultrasonography. If that is not available, we can do MRCP. If that is not available or patient is claustrophobic, then you can go for the CT angio. So in treatment options, the treatment depends upon the size of the stone. What is the size of the duct? Duct is dilated, non-dilated. What is the location of the stones? What are the numbers of the stones? That is the multiple or single stones. Then presence of stricture, ampullary stricture associated in the pathology. What is the gallbladder status of the patient? And what is the risk assessment? What is the risk to the patient? So for the very high risk patient, we are already not fit for any major surgery. So we have to find some easy treatment options than the some major surgery. So the commonest condition is patient has gallstone with CBD stones. So this is common, almost seen in 5 to 7% of the patients. So in that case, so we have got two options. First is the either you do CBD stone clearance by the ERCP and do then later on you do laparoscopic cholecystectomy, or simultaneously in one setting you do laparoscopic CBD exploration, stone extraction, and then cholecystectomy. So the laparoscopic CBD stone extraction followed by cholecystectomy is a preferred choice of treatment options because it is a single stage operation and clearance rate is almost 90 to 95%, less morbidity. But only limitation is that you need experienced surgeons and increased instrumentation. For the laparoscopic CBD stone extraction followed by cholecystectomy, there are two approaches. The first is the transcystic approach and second is transcholecystectomy approach. What is transcystic approach? Suppose the requirement for the transcystic approach is the stone has to be less than 9 mm diameter and the cystic duct has to be patent. That means you pass the instrument or basket through the cystic duct into the conbile duct, you grasp the stone and you take out through the cystic duct. But nowadays in our clinical practice, if the stones are that small, we prefer to do ERCP first, do the stone extraction, and then do cholecystectomy. So nowadays, just to know the techniques, you should know this. It can be done transcystic, but nowadays it is not done so commonly. So the indication for transcystic is a stone less than 9 mm, there are few in number, and the cystic duct has to be normal, patent. The commonest technique is done is the transcholecystectomy. That means you do the cholecystectomy, open the conbile duct, supraduodenal duct, and then you take out the stone. So you can see first step in the stone extraction is the cholecystectomy. That means we are taking out the, we are opening the conbile duct. So this is conbile duct here. This is the duodenum below here. I have retracted gallbladder. So now we are opening the conbile duct, supraduodenal portion of the conbile duct in the midline. So you can appreciate the bile with, some stone crush articles are coming out. So once, depending upon the size of the stone, we have to do adequate cholecystectomy. So once that cholecystectomy is done, what we have to do? We have to do the stone extraction. This stone extraction can be done just with the milking of the stones from the conbile duct. You can appreciate there are multiple stones into the conbile duct, common hepatic ducts. Even if you are taking out the stone from the right and left hepatic ducts. So this is a milking way. If you can also appreciate here, there are large multiple stones in the conbile duct. So these are the conditions where direct conwell CBD exploration is preferred over the ERCP. Otherwise, for ERCP, you require multiple settings of ERCP or multiple types of instrumentation, like the baskets, balloons, and the lithotripsy machines to take out all such large stones. If patient has gallstone with CBD stone, which are large, in one setting, we can do this cholecystectomy with colonoscopy and stone extraction. So this is how we can, even with the saline irrigation also, you can take out the multiple stones from the lower CBD. Again, with the help of basket, you can grab this stone and you can take it out. This is how. So this is basket extraction of the CBD stones. You must have heard about the Strigon kidney stones. So this patient had Strigon common welded stone. You can appreciate this is the one horn of the right hepatic duct and one horn of the left hepatic duct. So these are very large and really challenging stones, which can be easily tackled with laparoscopy than ERCP. So once you take out the stone, you must confirm the stone clearance with the colonoscopy. That means you can peep inside the bile duct to make sure that all the stones are removed. This stone clearance is confirmed, then we can close the corn bile duct either over the internal stent or we can close it over the T-tube. So this is the primary closure of the corn bile duct over the stent, or we can close it over the T-tube. Nowadays, this T-tube insertion is almost not done so routinely. We prefer to do internal stenting and the closure. But you should also know this, just that T-tube closure also can be done. What is the role of endoscopy? Endoscopy, if there is an impacted stone at the ampulla with severe cholangitis or associated pancreatitis because of the ampullary stone, so we have to treat this cholangitis first in emergency. So you can just do sphincterotomy and the stones will be deliver out. So this patient respond very well to decompression of the biliary tree after ERCP. Once this cholangitis is controlled, then you can consider this patient for the cholecystectomy. If there are the large stones, missed out stone after CBD exploration or after cholecystectomy, stones are identified. So you are already done cholecystectomy. You can appreciate that the CBD assisted duct stump here. So this patient cholecystectomy was done. After cholecystectomy, there is a residual stone. These stones are better taken out by the ESCP rather than again exposing this patient or subjecting this patient for the second laparoscopy procedure. Or there is a large ampullary stones. So this large ampullary impacted stone, they are very difficult to grasp or milk out with the colonoscopy during laparoscopy. So they are better taken out by the ERCP. We appreciate a huge corn belted stone impacted at ampulla and very thick infected bile. So this is the stone, huge stone. So these are better managed with the ERCP. They are like small multiple stones like this with a properly dilated ERCP. So you can do wide sphincterotomy. All small soft stones can be taken out very easily with the ERCP. You can appreciate now these stones are coming out. What is the strategy? If the gallbladder is intact, stones are large, no cholangitis, do laparoscopic CBD exploration with cholecystectomy in one setting. But if the gallbladder is intact and the stones are small, CBD is not dilated. Why you should not do this colotocotomy non-dilated corn bile duct? Because there are formation of the stricture. If you suture this corn bile duct after taking out the stone, there are chances of development of the stricture if the corn bile duct is not dilated. So in that case, you must do ERCP first and then laparoscopic cholecystectomy. Again, if the gallbladder is removed, there is no gallbladder, and post cholecystectomy there are CBD stones, then you, and there is no stricture, you should do ERCP. But if there is CBD stricture, benign stricture with stone, you must do biliary enteric bypass. What is that? That means you anastomose corn bile duct with the duodenum. So you bypass the strictures, lower strictures portion of the corn bile duct, and so that the patient doesn't develop recurrent cholangitis and the corn bile duct stones. So you have to treat stone also and the lower CBD stricture also. Once you bypass, if you do, so this is CBD. This is stomach. This is duodenum. This is now lower CBD. What we do? This is this part of the CBD is stitched with the first part of the duodenum like this. So we do colodoco duodenostomy here. Okay. So bile, instead of draining through the ampulla, it is drained through this colodoco duodenostomy into the duodenum directly. So this stricture part is bypassed. So suppose this is the stricture here. This is obstruction. So this is bypassed and through this bile will flow. So for the stone, if the primary stones are due to colodocal cyst, that means the dilatation, what we do, so what we do, just take out this part of the we excise the cystic part and then we stitch this stomach to this. So we stitch stomach to the hepatic duct. So this hepatico duodenostomy or hepatico jejunostomy. In colodocal cyst. We'll discuss it later in next lecture. Okay. So thank you very much. Next time we'll discuss about the colodocal cyst, management of the colodocal cyst, and maybe hepatoma. And after that, we'll discuss about the portal hypertension. And then only remaining organ will be then pancreas. Okay, thank you very much.